Ladies and gentlemen, you have participated in an absolutely extraordinary conference, and there's one thing you haven't really been clued in on, or it has not been revealed to you yet, which is why this conference is happening and who is responsible for this extraordinarily stimulating and educational opportunity we have all had. That man is Sunny Varkey, the head of the founder of GEMS Education. He has founded GEMS Education, of course, but his foundation, the Varkey GEMS Education Foundation, also does extraordinary work, particularly in teacher training. But I think that the most distinctive feature about Sunny is his extraordinary ambition and vision. He's somebody who has dreamed big ever since he began with his one school, and he continues to dream big even though he has a vast business empire, and he is dreaming big about the possibilities of extending education to really all the children of the world. You know, earlier his foundation announced that they were essentially creating a Nobel Prize in education, a $1 million prize to be given to the best educator of the year. And the nominations are going to begin, are being opened right now. So while we have all enjoyed ourselves, while we have all learned a lot, I ask you to take a moment to recognize Sunny Varkey as he comes on the stage to say a few words. Sunny.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor to have the opportunity to speak to you, all of you all today. Firstly, I must thank His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Vice President and Prime Minister of the UAE and ruler of Dubai, for honoring us with this patronage for this event. It is His Highness's vision that has inspired all of us who have worked on this conference today. We could not have done any of this without his support. It was 5 years ago we first had the idea of this conference, the Global Education Skills Forum. Now, as I look around, I see many good friends, I see statesmen and entrepreneurs, and best of all, teachers. And I know that we have succeeded. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for traveling here from around the world, for sharing your ideas and experiences, for helping making this conference a catalyst for real and rapid change. Now, I have some small confession to make. I do not enjoy public speaking. In fact, I spent most of my life avoiding it. I'm only here because I have something very important to say, something that I'm very passionate about. My parents were both teachers. They came to Dubai in 1959 as immigrants from Kerala, South India. Along with many people who moved to Dubai at the time, they came because they had a dream. My father started teaching English as a foreign language. Then together, they opened up and ran their first school catering to the Indian expats. It was called Our Own English High School. It was from that school, myself and a team of good people have been able to build a network of schools by the grace of God. As a child, I will never forget the respect my parents were shown. I will never forget how they were rewarded. I will never forget how they were celebrated. Respect for teachers was taken as a given back then. I certainly respected my teachers, and I simply admired them. Teachers have been respected, rewarded, and celebrated throughout the human history. This is fair, and this is just. It was the teachers who laid down the very foundations of our society. In ancient Greece, there was Aristotle. In China, there was Confucius. They were both teachers. Things have changed, and not for the better. For me, this is worrying, and I'm sure it is for you too. I'm concerned that this respect is vanishing. I do not know what has caused this. It might be something about our society, or our economy, or technology. Who knows? But I do know that this is real, and it is happening. We see it in our streets, we see it in our schools, and we see it in the media. Now just look at the kind of people we celebrate. When was the last time you saw a teacher on the front cover of any major international magazine? I don't think I've ever seen one. Every year, Time magazine has their top 10 people of the year. I can't remember the last time I saw a teacher appear on that list. The reality is that having a picture of a teacher on the front page of a global magazine may not achieve their sales targets. This is our society, and we are all to blame for this. But I wonder, what does this say about the value we place on education? The value we place on our children? The value we place on our futures? We all know that there is a problem. In fact, last year we commissioned the research into the status of teachers around the world. The study showed that there is still a great respect for teachers in some parts of the world, like China, South Korea, and Singapore. But it also showed that in other parts of the world, respect was much lower. My fear is that the problem is going to go from bad to worse. I believe respect for teachers is falling at just the moment when the importance of teachers is growing. The world needs great teachers to grow great minds. Otherwise, we will never tackle the challenges being faced in the world: climate change, conflict, and poverty. Human civilization only moves forward because hardworking and committed teachers are there behind every scene, pushing people on, cajoling, guiding, pointing the way forward. There was a teacher behind every great inventor, every great philosopher, every great idea in history: Michelangelo, Shakespeare, Nelson Mandela, Mahatma Gandhi, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs. All great and fiercely independent minds, but all nurtured and inspired early in their lives by great teachers. When I talk to teachers in my schools, they often tell me about what they call magic moments. They tell me these magic moments are what they strive for. They are the things that every teacher desires to achieve. These are the moments when a child's eyes light up, their curiosity has been sparked, they have a burning desire to find out more. That's when a teacher knows that they have done a good job. I said, I want to see these magic moments. The teacher says, but you can't, Mr. Varkey. The pupils act differently when you are in the room. So now I spy on these lessons. And just now and then, I witness one of those magic moments myself. And I see we have lit the spark of curiosity, which we must then fan and build up to grow the children who can help solve the challenges of the world. We all want our society to move forward. We must hear this moral calling. All of us care about education, care about creating a peaceful world. We must work together and do whatever it takes to put the importance of teachers at the forefront. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, that's why we have created a $1 million prize to find the greatest teacher in the world. By doing this, we are doing something really radical. And it's just not about money. It's about unearthing thousands of stories of courage and inspiration. We are really sending out a clear signal. We have done something that no one has ever done before. The reason we are doing this is to raise the bar of respect for teachers, to ensure teachers are properly rewarded, to see teachers celebrated like stars. Our prize will be every bit as great and prestigious as winning a Nobel Prize or an Oscar. And my hope is that the children from around the world will watch the ceremony in remote villages and towns, in big cities, from Dubai to Dublin, from Los Angeles to Lima, from Moscow to Mumbai. I want to excite and inspire them like Hollywood movies. I want the brightest and the best students dreaming of becoming brilliant teachers. That's how they can make a real difference to the world. I know there are many millions of unsung teachers out there. Our prize will celebrate all of them. But in particular, we will shine a spotlight on one extraordinary teacher for the world to see. And the world will be hungry to hear the secret of their success. Our winner will be an inspiration for a generation. Writing books, giving lectures, appearing on television. We want to see them appearing on the covers of those leading magazines, and I think we will. Now look, I don't think it'll be easy to raise the bar of respect for teachers. I know this won't happen overnight. It takes a long time to change attitude and perceptions. But to do nothing would be to admit defeat. I am determined to do whatever it takes to achieve this. When you get older, you think less about your inheritance and more about your legacy. When I was young, I inherited a school from my parents. Now I'm older, I want to pay tribute to them. With the grace of God. With the grace of God, I want to see teachers properly respected, rewarded, and celebrated across the world. So without further delay, I am thrilled to announce that the nominations are now open for the Varkey Gems Foundation Global Teacher Prize 2014. I'm especially grateful to His Highness and to President Clinton for the support they have given to the prize and to this grand initiative. But Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, this is just the beginning of the journey. The truth is that there is never any reward that will be enough to fully repay the debt we all owe to our teachers. But we can play our part in honoring one of the world's greatest professions with this prize. By celebrating teachers, we all win. Because we need great teachers to grow great minds, to create a more peaceful, a more secure, and a more just world. Let's work together, and together, let us create a legacy that will be remembered for generations. Thank you.
If I could ask the panelists for the final panel to come up on the stage. I have one thought after listening to Sunny's remarkable speech, which is that it's strange that we do not value the one profession that makes all other professions possible. If you think about it, teaching is the profession that makes every other profession possible, and yet it is the one perhaps least valued among these professions that we talk about. Well, we have. I have one problem here, which is with so many heads of state, I don't know how I'm going to proceed, whether to do it alphabetically, by order of the longest tenure in the job, per capita GDP growth over the period you were in office. But instead, what I'm going to do is follow an age-old chivalrous principle and begin with the one lady we have. And then move on somewhat randomly. What I thought we'd do, we have such an extraordinary opportunity here to talk about, so many different things. And I was looking at the extraordinary group of people we have here. And I noticed that everyone here, and George Papandreou pointed this out to me, has lived under a closed political regime at some point. And then presided over a democratic system. And many of you come from Southern, Central Europe, Central Asia. There is a geographic reality here, the one exception, of course, being Chile. But Chile is such an exception wherever it is, because of its extraordinary growth over the last 25 years. People often call Chile an East Asian country that happens to be in Latin America because of its achievements. But I thought what we'd start with, if we may, with the former president of Kyrgyzstan, Rosa Otunbayeva. Rosa, tell us what it feels like in terms of, the challenge for people living in a place that's not just closed politically, but closed off from the world in some ways. Sometimes might feel not at the center. How did you look at the world, and how do you stay connected?
Farid, you are the most famous anchor of the most popular TV, and please do not think that we are out of touch. In opposite, my country is sandwiched between Russia and China. We are just in the center of the Eurasia, and I just want to tell you how tired we are from this transition. And all of us, we've heard yesterday what Mr. Clinton was telling about Ukraine, and in 2010 exactly the same sort of line of events happened in my country. 2010 and 2011, we fixed this situation. We have changed our constitution, and we went from the presidential to the parliamentary form of governing of my country. And tiredness from transition is in the fact of deterioration of education, of social situation. And it's very sad to see how in what a good education we used to have in Soviet days. And then education was falling down and down. And in my country, for example, we face such a problem that only 15% of children, they are prepared to go to school. But literacy, thanks God, is high. When I keep here for the day before, my Afghan sister, she said, more than 90% of women are illiterate. No, it is not the case in my country. We have literate population, but we have all this problem of transition, like migration, heavy migration from every country of the former Soviet Union, and so they are problem of education of those migrants going to Russia, either to Middle East and other parts of the world. And certainly we have the problems of girls also. So with this regard, I would say, yes, you are right. Please don't forget about our area, Central Asia, which is about 60 million population, which needs also world attention. And all of us, we inspired, we got the seeds of inspiration from this conference. And I must tell you that Mr. Varkey, who is really, to my mind, is today like Bill Gates of education in this part. I would praise and I would take from this conference so many lines, so many ideas, so many trends. And I want to ask you, Mr. Varkey, not just those metropolitan, world metropolitan, New York and South Africa and Hong Kong and Dubai, where you want to have such a world conferences on education, but also in each region, which is important for the world. And Central Asia is another troubled place where all the world powers are around. So, and we want very much attention of all of us, educators. Please come to my country, please come to our region, and give us all this knowledge about the new trends in pedagogic, in education, and world development.
Thank you very much, thank you. You know, you're right that you are sandwiched between two very large countries, and there's a saying in India about this, with countries that are close to India and China. They say that when the elephants dance, we get very nervous. And I think that you can imagine that you're in a state of perpetual nervousness. George Papandreou, you grew up and went to school, I assume, almost everywhere. You grew up in Greece under the colonels. Your father was teaching at Berkeley, so you must have been there. You were in Canada. You've seen all these different educational systems. What do you think, do you think that there is an answer in terms of going forward? Is there one you looked at when you were running Greece as a model?
Well, I was faced with a major crisis then, as you know, and we were like a ship which was on an odyssey with holes in it, and we were bailing out water, but as every day, and at the same time, we had to think of revamping, reorganizing the whole ship and the machine and so on. And these two things together were very difficult, to do reforms on the one hand, but on the other hand, do the day-to-day cuts and austerity. And we've talked about this, Fareed, in the past. But I really believed in education. I'm so happy to be in this conference here, because education for me and being in this community is sort of a breath of fresh air. And I thank Mr. Varkey for this, because I linked education with democracy. I lived, as you said, in many countries. I went to 8 different schools in 12 different years in 3 different languages. And I saw in Greece a system where it was, because of the authoritarianism both before and during the dictatorship. I remember when I was a quite quiet boy, and at the end of the school year, a professor pulled me up to the front and he said, a teacher pulled me up to the front and he said, "I haven't beaten you up this year." And he beat me up in front of the class. And then I left and I went to Sweden as a refugee. And in somewhat fearful, I put my hand up and I said to one of the professors, one of the teachers, I wanted to ask a question, which was bold enough from coming from that kind of a system. I said, "Sir," and he looks at me and says, "My name isn't Sir, my name is John. Call me John." So immediately I realized that an educational system can be authoritarian, or it can be liberating. It can be liberate the potential. And that's what I think democracy and is linked with education in many ways. And that goes back to ancient Greece, to the idea that even politics, is the belief in the potential of human beings, that we can change our world. And if we want to change our world, and we can do that, we can imagine a different world, we have to have the skills, we have to have the knowledge, we have to use our potential. So games and theater and athletics and philosophy and science flourished out of that. That's where, why democracy is so important. But coming to more, to a more modern world, when I came back to Greece, I got involved in adult education, and it was basically sort of civic education, learning a bit from the Swedish model, but also from another educator, Paulo Freire, who I worked with from Brazil, who had worked in Africa also, about how you create a democratic culture, how you build. And we, I went around Greece organizing courses all over, about 100,000 people were involved. And what I found, which was quite interesting, is that we were trying to get women to be involved and learn their rights and break from the mold, in the, particularly in the rural areas, but the men wouldn't let them come to these courses. So we had to set up sewing and knitting courses, which they actually came to. And then during the sewing and knitting course, we would say, now, why don't we talk to you about your rights also? And that was very important, because that really gave them the skills, the social skills, if you like, to be able to then go out even on the labor market and become more active and participating in a democratic society. But from my experience of adult education, the pedagogy of adult education, I think, is what we need to bring to the formal system. The pedagogy of adult education, in a peculiar sense, has all the things we talked about in this conference. First of all, it is more modular and linked to the needs on a personalized basis. If you are an adult, depending on your experience and what you want, you create your curriculum in a sense. Secondly, it is a there is a respect between each other. There is a sort of an equal participation. There is a teacher, but it's more of a guide and a mentor, not so much from the head of the classroom, but it's more of a helping mentor type of a process. And another one, which I think is very important, is that everybody is an educator. Everybody brings his or her experience. So let's think of a school, the school today, more as where everybody in society can be an educator. Every institution, whether it's government, whether it's NGOs, whether it's private sector, becomes a learning organization. And the school becomes more of an organizer of the resources of knowledge, organizer of resources of education. At the local level, they can bring in the local people from local community, the teachers also, but it could be an archaeologist in Greece, or a person working in the hotel sectors, or the tourism sectors, or in the green energy sector, or the shipping sector. But it also could be using the commonwealth that we have now of global knowledge. So I think that we this is from my experience, and that was, as a prime minister, what I wanted to do is open up the system so it can really be moving from a more hierarchical, authoritarian system, which has its background in a not only industrial world, but a very much an authoritarian world, into a much more open, liberating, educative system, which creates gives great potential, empowers our citizens to be active in not only in jobs, for jobs, but for in public life and participation in creativity in a more general sense.
That's a fascinating point you make about the importance of creating this sense of liberation. And I think that also the sense of skepticism and questioning. So that one of the things that I find that is most different between the kind of Asian educational systems and Western ones, and the American is in a sense the extreme here, is the degree of deference to the teacher. And I think it's a balance where you want the teacher to be given respect, but you also want the teacher's ideas to be contested, to be challenged. I remember reading somewhere that Niels Bohr, the great scientist, every time he would begin a lecture, he would begin it by saying, please remember, everything I am telling you is a provisional hypothesis that I am making. It may all be wrong. And then he would give his lecture. Peter, you were running Hungary in a very similar moment, right after an authoritarian or communist rule. But you were also moving toward Europe very dramatically.
Can you talk a little bit about what that was like, the change in a educational system as it goes from one almost civilization or society to another?
Yes, thank you. First of all, I would like to apologize because of my English. And first of all, I would like to apologize Mr. William Shakespeare because I speaking very poor English. So
our Hungarian is even worse, so you should not feel embarrassed.
So I would like to speaking about the disappointment of the Hungarian people, disappointment of the people in the Central and Eastern Europe, because with the changing of regime, everybody was convinced that it's very easy to get a better life, more knowledge, to be rich, and so on and so on. And we have to state that all over in the world, even in Hungary and the Central and Eastern Europe, there is a strong polarization of the fortunes, of the revenues, of the social life, in the access to the knowledge and learning. And I would like to speaking especially about the minorities living in Hungary. Yeah. Because we have a quite important minority. This is the Roma population. And this is not unique in Central and Eastern Europe, because a lot of countries has a very important minority. Roma minority. The Roma minority representing around 8 to 10% of the population. It's not nothing. And the half of the population who suffer privation is Roma in Hungary. That means the Roma population is strongly 5 times overrepresented in poverty, but underrepresented in learning. In Hungary, 28% of the population has the university degree. In the Roma population, you have 1%. 1% to 28%. And unfortunately, the Roma population is underrepresented in employment rate too. The employment rate in Hungary is quite low, it's 51-52%. But the employment rate in Roma population is 25%. Wow. And if you're looking at the ladies, the Roma ladies, they are 20% only who are employed, which is very, very, very big problem in my mind. That's from the other side, we have to state also that is a very rapidly growing in the population, the Roma population. That's the structure of the population is changing very quickly. So, all the governments, since the changing of the regime, that's 1990, did something to for the integration of the Roma population. But frankly speaking, that is not only not enough, but it's very, very, very few and very small result. In the last 2-3 years, the government decided to make some measures, which is very important, the mandatory kindergarten of 3 years of age. This is very important because in our conference yesterday or today, I don't know, was a panel discussing about when to start to learning and when to start to, the education. And this is a good answer because we have to start very, very early to have some result and to change really the mentality of the people. But we did a lot of other measures. I don't want to speak in details about these questions. But from the other side, we decided also to make some punitive measures, for example, by cutting the families of benefits if children do not attend the school, which is very important. Maybe I see, Mr. Zakaria, you thinking about this is good or not. Mm-hmm. We're thinking too. But finally, I think without this, it's very difficult to get some result. But we have to move much, much faster. The solving the Roma question and the education in the Roma population needed a political consensus between the different political parties and tendencies. We have to do more for decreasing the strong social prejudice, because there is a very strong present in Hungary, the prejudice to the minority, to the Roma minority. And we have to reduce the number of the segregated schools, because the experiences shows, the segregated school assure the reproduction of the problems and the difficulties in the Roma population. We have to make a lot in the other fields, like, for example, to change the redistribution system of the budget, to give priority to the education and to the integration of the Roma population. So that was only one question, but this question concerned the Hungarian politicians and the Hungarian society, and we have to solve this question. And the solution is the education, the learning, and to thinking together and to have the partnership.
Thank you very much. And of course, the Roma population in Hungary, the sometimes called the Gypsies, is a problem every country has. In some way, there is always some disadvantaged minority that is not part of the mainstream. And so often the question is how to educate them, how to provide particular access, because that is the only long-term way that these populations will be assimilated into the mainstream of society. So your challenge is, in a sense, a challenge that is faced by everyone. Ricardo Lagos, I was joking about Chile, but you know, it really is extraordinary if you look back over the last 30 or so years. Chile has had a growth rate that really resembles Thailand, South Korea, these very extraordinary cases, the so-called Asian tigers. And you're right next door to lots of Latin American countries, very similar in many ways. What do you think made Chile different? And does it have something to do with education? Does it have to do with human capital in some way?
Excuse me. If I first say a few things about the speech that we just listened before, I think that Sunny and the way that he spoke about the teacher and how important is the teacher when we are talking about education and changes in education, he was referring to the most important task that we have. And I think that if he defined this conference as a catalyst for quick and rapid change, let me use my own experience in Chile with regard to that. Because I can tell you a success story, quote unquote. 25 years ago, we have 200,000 students in higher education. In today's Chile, 1,200,000 in just 25 years. And I came here and can say very proudly, look, of 10 university students, 7 is first generation in their families. Happy picture. Nevertheless, nevertheless, let me tell you, in spite of that, changes in education has not been enough. Why? During the 20th century, the question was coverage, quantity. How many students in primary education, in secondary education, at the university? And we were able to improve that. When I was Minister of Education, right after the dictatorship was defeated in the first democratic government in 1990, well, we have a 100% coverage in basic education, in primary, and about 85% in secondary education. And this is why, when I was president in 2003, I decided that compulsory education was going to be 12 years, because now everybody can attend elementary and secondary school. That's good. But as the coverage was increasing, the quality of that education was not being to keep up the standards. And this is why the students, about 10 years ago, and later on, has complained about the quality of the schools where they are going to. Because you can say, look, sir, from this school, about 80% will go to the university. They will pass the examinations. But from the other school, no more than 10%, or even less. So what kind of education is not very fair? What we discover is that equal opportunity means that you have to discriminate. You have to give more when you have less. There is a very close correlation between socioeconomic status and what is going to be the results from the educational point of view. The lowest, the families that belong to the lowest 20% of our income group, no more than 4% were able to reach the university in 1990. In today's Chile, 16%, 4 to 16. But the upper 20% went from 40 to 60. So still, even though our figures are good, the question of how social mobility is doing in Chile is not working very well. And this is what I think is the most important issue, not in Chile, in today's educational discussion. We all know that in a democratic society, social mobility is essential. The story of what can accomplish in this country, the son of a migrant professor coming from India, is quite remarkable. The question is, this kind of success story, how many Chileans or how many Latin Americans can tell about? In other words, because you have been able to increase coverage, till what extent? And now we are very proud, there's so many Chileans going to university. But you have to pay for that, as I said before. And this is why students are on the street. And when you go to a street, this is very interesting. Students and their families that go to street to complain are not the lowest poor family. Because if you belong to those 16% of the lowest 20%, you get a scholarship. Who are going to the streets? Those that get a credit, and you have to pay for that, because the credit is inflation plus 6%, extremely high. And therefore, the big issue is now, Chile is better off, you can make a subsidy with regard to their rate of interest. But the big discussion is, how are you going to have an education system, educational system that can guarantee social mobility in today's Chile? And no matter where you are born, you can accomplish the dreams that you have because you are living in a more inclusive society, in a society that has better cohesion. And this is why in today's Chile, the new administration, the question of educational reform is at the center. But then the question of how are we going to finance that reform is also at the center. And this is why then now we are talking about what kind of tax reform. There is no question that the private sector has an extremely important role to play. But be careful. If the private sector is only for profit, then they will be able to solve the issue of the highest population in Chile that can afford to pay for that. And the big issue is, in a democratic system, how are you going to be able to allow that everybody can go to elementary, to secondary, and to higher education if they are able to pass examinations? Last point that I think is extremely important. As yesterday, Bill Clinton says very eloquently that all of us are equal with regard to intelligence, and all of us are equal with regard to the dreams that we have. It's true. The problem is that all of us are not equal when we enter the first grade in primary school, because at that level, first year at primary school, when you are 6 years old, you are going to be different from the other kid, depending who went on who were not to a pre-basic school. And once that you discover that, then the big issue is, how are you going to go to coverage to the kids from 2 to 6 years old? And let me tell you, this is crucial for a more democratic society. So it's not only a question of higher education, it's a question of the small kids and what kind of education, quote unquote, can have before they enter to the first degree in elementary school. Final point that I would like to make. In this discussion, in this 2 days discussion, I think that something very important when the discussion about the media, about the new technologies, how that can change. And this morning I learned, in one of the panels that I attended, that from the private point of view, it was possible to give primary education for $6 a day. Wonderful. But at the same time, in some of the panel I learned that in Latin America, I had no idea about that, that because of the new computer system, the new mobile things, it's possible then to have 1 year at the university level, online, for $25 per month. That gives you an idea of the difference that we have, and to what extent there is hope with regard to the future of education. Because at the very end, education is about making possible to guarantee that all human dignities have similar dignity because they are able to reach similar dreams, no matter where they were born. And at the very end, that means to have very clear what are going to be the different criteria to face the educational problems in changing societies like the one that we are living right now in this planet. Thank you, sir.
It's a fascinating set of comments, Mr. President, and leaves one much to think about. The one point I wonder whether it'd be worth exploring further at some point, perhaps privately, is your point about the importance of access at all levels and whether the private sector can play that role. I would only remind you that when the private sector opens restaurants, it doesn't only open restaurants for the rich. McDonald's makes a healthy profit by offering poor people food as well. You can find in any business there are ways of catering at every level. And so I think we should, given that you agree that the needs are so great that we should have all elements of society involved, it'd be an interesting conversation.
Excuse me, one point I didn't say very clear. Most of our enrollment increase at the university system is through the private sector and the private system.
I see.
Most of that. And that part of the problem, because you have to pay for that. So this is the discussion that we have.
Yeah.
But this is, as I'd like to say, look, the fact that we have university students in the street is much more important than not to have nobody on the street, because those students enter the university. And now they can complain. But it's better to have university students complaining than not to have university students. Let me put that way.
And of course, university students have to complain at some level. Danilo Turk, Slovenia is another country in transition, breaking off from the former Yugoslavia, charting your own course. How important do you think, how important a role has education played, because Slovenia is also a great success story?
Well, education has been part of our identity for a long time and has been an important priority for the country historically. And that goes a century back and has been continuous. We have lived in four different systems in that century, and education has always been central to our perception of ourselves and also to our perception of our future. Let me tell you a small story of an experience I had in a previous country, in Yugoslavia. I was a young professor at that time, and it was in mid-1980s. There was a visit of the then president of Tanzania, Julius Nyerere, in our country. He came to Ljubljana. He visited our university, and he was awarded the title of honorary doctor, doctor honoris causa. And then the vice chancellor of our university, rector, he called me and said, Danilo, look, you are a young professor of international law, you should know something about these things. Why don't you write a nice speech for me and explain why are we giving this honorary doctorate to Dr. Julius Nyerere? And be sure that the speech is coherent and that there is a central idea. And I answered, I said, look, this is not going to be difficult at all, because the nickname and the honor name of Julius Nyerere is Mwalimu, in Swahili meaning the teacher. So what would be better than giving an honorary doctorate to a teacher who is a very well-respected statesman? And you know, this corresponds to our perception of importance of teaching. When Mr. Varkey earlier on spoke about the cultures which have a high esteem of teachers, like the Chinese tradition with Confucius, or the ancient Greece with Socrates, who continues to live with us in the Western culture very much in many respects, I would say we have to look for modern examples, and I believe that Julius Nyerere is one of these examples of our era, who show that teaching is an honorable profession and one of central importance. Now, in Slovenia, that would not be difficult to argue, and it would be easily accepted. However, once this is accepted, we have to be rather clear in the definition of problems. I have been following this conference for 2 days, and I have been fascinated by the knowledge, experience, and passion with which participants have addressed a very wide variety of issues. And two things are kept in my mind. One is, the world doesn't appreciate sufficiently the fact that the right to education is a fundamental human right. When we talk about human rights, we normally talk about violations and we talk about political rights, but very seldom we talk about education. I think it has to be brought more to the center of the international discussion on human rights. And of course, whatever was said about 2015, the new development goals, is one of the vehicles with which we can achieve progress in that regard. And the second thing is really a very big crisis which is now expected, and we in Slovenia already feel very much, and that is the mismatch between what the national educational systems provide to young people and the demands of an evolving economy which is more and more global. So that mismatch creates a problem of which is sometimes called the technological unemployment, calling for really a fundamental rethinking, redefinition of educational systems, and also lifelong learning. And of course, we have heard much about that, so I'm not going to repeat that. From the Slovenian perspective, this is probably the most dramatic challenge that we now have. How to adjust our system? Now, the system which has been there for a very long period, for a long historic period, and has survived and evolved through these different political stages from the Habsburg monarchy to Yugoslavia to European Union, and with a short period of full and complete sovereignty in between. The question is, how do we adjust now? What do we do? How do we make sure that our particular university education produces the kind of knowledge which people will need in the future? We don't have clear answers to that, and the system is simply too rigid to provide one. And therefore, I think we need international cooperation, we need examples, we need to work together with others. Now, this is in brief our experience, and I would like to conclude by saying this conference is really very useful in that regard, because, and I hope it will be publicized widely and it will grow as the time requires, and I hope that next year or perhaps a year later, after the new millennium goals are defined, there will be a greater sense of centrality of education in the global development. This is what I would say.
You know, this has been a fascinating conversation, a fascinating discussion. You have each drawn on such a rich vein of experience that you have in each of your countries, in each of your experiences. And what I think it highlights, as you were saying, Danilo Turk, is the importance of these kind of conferences, because education, it seems to me, is going through two or three very dramatic transformations. The first is the transformation that just tens of millions, perhaps hundreds of millions more people are being educated. The second is that in the Western world at least, but perhaps everywhere, education is going to have to become a lifelong experience, because transitions are taking place at a much more rapid pace. No one stays in one job for their lives. No one stays in one industry or one sector for their lives. And so you have to continuously retool. And then you have this extraordinary technological shift that is transforming every aspect of life. But particularly education, when we talk about the knowledge economy, what we forget is that the knowledge piece of it, at the heart of it, the university and school systems have been remarkably unchanged. The knowledge economy has transformed everything but the knowledge business. And this is not going to last. We are going to see very dramatic transformations. And so for all those reasons, it seems to me that the old debates about public versus private are irrelevant, that what we need is an all-hands-on-deck approach, and everybody participating and figuring out how to address these challenges. You know, I was watching like President Clinton in a much smaller way, I have an interest in physics, and I was watching a new documentary about the Large Hadron Collider in Europe. It's called Particle Fever. And it, what you saw here was this extraordinary experience of 3,000 scientists from all over the world united in a quest for knowledge, and really for a quest for fundamental knowledge. And these people, they were all immigrants, really, and they came from all parts of the world, and they were working together in teams, including from countries that were at war with one another, or at least had very bad, poor relations. You had Israelis and Arabs. You had Indians and Pakistanis. You had Greeks and Turks. That, to me, is the kind of power of education, and that is the transformative power that it might have, and that is why I think you're so right when you talk about the Millennium Goals and how this could be at the heart of them, because it's not just that it will improve society and improve one economy, it also has the effect of improving the world. I really do believe that so many of our problems are a lack of education. I want to conclude by just thanking Sunny Varkey again for the prize, because I think it's so important to sensationalize, if one may put it that way, as a member of the media, and to make this not something that is simply seen as a worthy profession, but also one that has some glamour attached to it. You know, Tom Friedman once said that if you want to understand why China is doing so well, remember one thing. In China, Bill Gates is Britney Spears. The problem, he said, in America is that Britney Spears is Britney Spears. And this is our chance to give a teacher the limelight in that way. And there's a great play by Robert Bolt about Sir Thomas More, in which this person comes up to Thomas More, the great theologian, and says to him, I want to be a teacher, but it seems as though it's a very small profession. If I become a teacher, who will know that if I'm a great teacher? And Thomas More says to him, your students and God, that's not a bad audience. But I think Sunny Varkey just made it an even better audience. So thank you very much. Hope you've had a good conference.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to request if you could stay seated. There is actually one more performance. If I can just again thank Fareed and our former heads of state, it has absolutely been a privilege to share this experience with you. However, as has become tradition with our forum, we wanted to end. We wanted to end with a performance from our young people, from the young people who essentially exemplify the reason that we're here. We're here to secure their future. So, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, will you join me in welcoming to the stage our students?
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? And why should my